Well, everything at the racetrack was looking pretty good. Everyone was pretty happy, and we're looking like we're in a pretty good position to head to the second round of this race series. If you've watched the series up to this point, you'll know that this car hates us, and basically anything it can do to chuck a spanner in the works and make our life just that little bit more difficult, it's exactly what it's going to do. So let's start by having a look at a little bit of data. All right, if we started looking at our entire session here, looking here at this green line, this is our diff temperature. So we can see this is during my session here. This particular part that's highlighted is lap 7. You can see up to this point it was following a fairly normal trajectory, and we get to the end of lap 7 and skyrockets. So that was what brought on the high diff temp warning. Interestingly, in Ben's session, which is here, we can see the diff temp actually tracks much more normally and no overheating situation. So we've got a situation like this. Obviously we need to dig in a little bit deeper and find out what's going on, and this is another area where having a power distribution module, or PMU from Ecumaster in our case, gives us a little bit more data. The PMU allows us to monitor the voltage, status and current on all of our outputs. We can then send this through via a CAN message to the Motec dash, where it then gets sent via telemetry back to the pits, and we've got that data that we can watch live. So particularly during Ben's outing, followed mine, we're watching the current. Let's have a look at the data from the entire session and see what that diff pump was doing. All right, again, we're looking at the entire session, and this yellow line that we've got down here is our diff current, diff pump current. So we can see that in particular during lap 7, the current ends up spiking quite dramatically during my session. I actually got to a point here where it hit 24 amps and switched off. One of the other advantages with a power management unit is that it's not just like a mechanical fuse. When it blows, that's it. We can actually reset that particular circuit, wait a certain amount of time, and then try it again. We've got that exact setup in our PMU. However, if the current remains excessive, then of course, to protect that particular circuit, the PMU will permanently shut down the diff pump. So that's what it did. That's why our diff temperature ended up skyrocketing after lap 7. So interesting, we needed to dive in a little bit deeper and find out what actually happened during that lap 7 and why was the pump current high. Let's have another look at the data and we'll see what happened during Ben's session. All right, so you can see here as Ben leaves the pits, the current is reasonably flat there, but straight away it's sitting at around about 5 amps compared to normally we see that sitting around about 2 to 3 amps. So the current draw straight away is higher. However, we also see this jump up in the current, it drops down and then it jumps up again. So definitely erratic, not what we want to see. It's one thing to know we've got a problem, but of course we need to find out what's causing that problem. This at least allows us to know where to look. So when we got the car back to the workshop, one of the areas we inspected was the differential. All we wanted to do is make sure that we weren't missing any teeth or any excessive amount of material was in the diff. Let's have a quick look at that now. So here we've got our diff. This is the factory Toyota 86 diff housing. It uses a Cusco 1.5-way clutch plate LSD, and it uses a shorter 4.556 final drive. One of the considerations with running a clutch plate LSD is, by definition, they are going to end up wearing over time, so they will put some material into the oil, and that's not necessarily a sign of an issue. However, nothing else really looked like it was a problem inside the diff. There were no teeth missing, the wear pattern on the crown wheel and pinion looked pretty normal, so nothing to be overly concerned about. The next potential area we wanted to inspect was the filter that we've got in our diff cooling pump system, so let's have a look at that.
This is the filter that we're running, which runs a -6 AM fitting on the inlet and outlet. This is the filter element, so it's a little stainless mesh filter. And when we pulled this apart, we did find some debris in the pleats of that filter. Not anything that I'm overly concerned about, but I don't also think that would probably be enough to cause the high current draw that we're seeing.
The other potential issue we may have, of course, is simply a faulty pump. So we've inspected the pump, can't visually find anything wrong with it, but we're going to test it again, and we will have a spare that we can switch into the car if we do continue to have problems. So that's one issue that we definitely need to get on top of. There's more though. Let's have a look back at our data.
This particular page here in our i2 telemetry shows us all of the relevant
engine data. So up here, as we've already had a quick look at, we've got our relevant temperatures. Here, we've got the information that we didn't have at Teretonga, which is our four exhaust gas temperature sensors. We've also got our lambda down here, and you'll notice that we actually had a faulty wideband controller at this point, so lambda 4 is not showing anything. Pretty hard to see much detail when we're looking at an entire 25 lap session, but what we want to really focus on here is our EGT. So the EGT here, this is during my session and nothing particularly unique going on there. We're seeing maximum temperatures sitting in the region of about 700 degrees. There is a spread across the four cylinders, but nothing particularly unusual there, and they're all pretty close to each other. We'll zoom in here for a better look, and we can sort of see the distribution that we've got here. Nothing particularly out of the ordinary. If we zoom back in though, look at what's happening when Ben's session is underway, which is this part here, where he leaves the track. And what we can see is a general trend here. If we look at the yellow data, which is for cylinder number two, you can kind of see that it's on an upward trajectory. Nothing particularly crazy. If we bring in our minimum and maximum, we see that the highest that cylinder two actually got to was still only 778 degrees, so nothing crazy there. But the more worrying thing is why it was on this upward trajectory and why it was different to my session. Interestingly, Tim and I were sitting in the truck while Ben was out on the track looking at the EGT data on the telemetry. I actually made a casual observation at the time that number two was tracking a little bit higher. And again, it was only about 20, 25 degrees, so definitely not enough for me to be concerned about it. When the car got back to the workshop, we unloaded it, of course, and straight away, as soon as Brandon moved it off the trailer, you could hear there was a ticking noise coming from the cylinder heads. And normally, if you've got a mechanical noise, it's something that you definitely want to dig into a little bit deeper. So once we got the car on the hoist, we got the rocker cover off and had a look at what was going on. And unfortunately, straight away, the issue became apparent. What had happened was we'd spat a shim out from one of the exhaust valves. I've actually got the shim here. So this is our shim. In the SR20VE cylinder head, that shim sets the valve lash, or the clearance between the cam essentially lifting, pushing against the rocker, and then the rocker pushes against the shim. So we need a little bit of clearance in there to make sure that everything works how it should. And the thickness of that shim is adjusted by the machinist in order to set the valve lash or valve clearance. On a lot of engines, this is done with a hydraulic lash adjuster. So this is maintenance free and it's pretty common these days, works reasonably well. In high RPM applications, some hydraulic lash adjusters have proven to be a little bit unreliable. So that's why in high RPM applications, often we will find that a mechanical lash adjuster system is still preferred. Downside, of course, though, is maintenance. Over time, everything wears, so you do actually have to check and adjust that lash from time to time, particularly on the VE cylinder head. That in itself is no small task. So why did this happen and where did it go? Of course, naturally, the shim was nowhere to be seen. It would be nice if that shim was sitting up in the rocker cover, or in the cylinder head, I should say, so we could recover it easily. Of course, that was never going to be the situation. Unfortunately, at a later point, by removing the Ross dry sump from the engine, we found that it was lodged in one of the scavenge filters in the sump. So no damage done there, and we probably got off pretty lightly. There's also really no damage to the cylinder head, other than the fact that obviously the retainer on that valve on number two cylinder on the exhaust side was looking pretty banged up. It had done probably the better part of eight laps with the rocker operating directly on the retainer. In hindsight, we're actually super lucky that we didn't end up dropping a valve. This is a case of probably a very narrow escape and what could have been. But let me get back to why this has happened. So what we do need to understand, and this is a pretty known fact, I talk about this pretty regularly in our course material, particularly in some of our members' webinars covering aspects such as limiter setup. The valve train, particularly on an engine like this, is quite sensitive to the way a limiter is set up. So what this means is that if you're using an ignition cut for the likes of a gear shift, an RPM limiter, or a speed limiter, you can have problems. Now, why that happens is that when you're using an ignition cut, we're controlling the engine RPM by cutting spark to randomized cylinders. That's fine, it does the job, it will control our RPM, which is what we're trying to achieve. The problem is that on that cylinder, we end up with a lung full, a complete cylinder full of unburned fuel in here being passed into the exhaust system. Now, not necessarily does that mean it's going to be an issue, but what can happen, particularly in a turbocharged engine, that unburned fuel and air can then combust in the exhaust system. Basically, it ignites on something hot, like the turbine wheel, the exhaust manifold, and combusts, it burns. What this does is it creates a pressure spike in the exhaust system, and this can be sufficient to pop an exhaust valve back off the seat. Now, if you're running a conventional hydraulic lifter, this will show up because when the exhaust valve pops back off the seat, the hydraulic lifter will instantly pump up to take up the excessive valve lash or clearance that now exists, and then your exhaust valve is actually held off the seat. Now, if you're really unfortunate, it can punch it into the top of the piston. That's not going to end well. Normally, though, under more mild circumstances, you end up with the exhaust valve just held open and you lose all compression on that cylinder. The engine starts running terribly. And we see this with a lot of people who are running a two-step launch control strategy to build boost on a turbocharged engine that runs limited, runs factory hydraulic lifters. If you use an aggressive launch control strategy with a lot of ignition retard, this is the exact situation that happens. Bring the engine up on the limiter, the ignition retard comes in, we're cutting ignition, fuel and air are combusting in the exhaust system very late in the engine cycle, and then it creates a lot of pressure spikes, pops those valves back open, you lose compression and the engine won't idle when you come back to idle. However, that's not the situation we encountered there, and I do know that this is a problem with this type of engine, so it's something that we do need to be mindful of. The obvious option here, which we see time and time again, is where an ignition cut's being used on a gear shift, particularly for a flat shift option with our sequential gearbox. This is pretty common how that is set up, and what this does is, again, creates that same situation, unburned fuel and air passing into the exhaust system where it ignites. It also sounds pretty cool. That's why you'll hear a lot of cars with sequential gearboxes on the gear shift, they will let out a fairly loud crack out of the exhaust. So that's that unburned fuel in the air exploding in the exhaust system. Again, this isn't news to me, and that was one of the tasks that I completed while I was setting up the gear change control. I was making sure that we were using a fuel cut to prevent this exact situation. The other situation we've got is our pit limiter. Now that does use a combination of both ignition and fuel cut. However, again, this really shouldn't cause us any issues. And given that the pit limiter is working at low throttle opening, we're only at about 30 to 40% throttle opening as we're coming down pit lane, and the engine RPM is relatively low. We're talking 3,500 RPM. Turbo is obviously not really doing much work at that point, so it would be unlikely to see enough exhaust gas energy to have the effect of popping those valves back open. So at this point, we were a little bit mystified. However, while we were examining the cylinder head in a little bit more detail, we actually found another separate issue. And this is where we could see that some of the shims on the exhaust side only were actually sitting down below the lip of the retainer. Now this is problematic because what this means is that the rocker can actually end up operating on the retainer instead of operating on the shim where it should be. Without being able to measure this, it looked like some of them were between perhaps 5 and 10 thou lower than the lip of the retainer. And you could also see that this had resulted in some wear on the lip of those retainers where the rocker had been wearing against it. So this definitely isn't right. That's not how it should be. We've discussed this with the machinist and the head was sent back to the machinist to rectify this. They put their hand up and took that on the chin and admitted that that's something they hadn't noticed. Now, I'm not blaming the engine machinist. Yes, they should have caught that, obviously, but this is something that's really important to understand when you are building engines. Ultimately, when you're building your own engines, the buck stops with the person doing the final assembly. So for me, that's my fault. I should have actually picked that up, and this is why at HPA we have that saying, which I've used a few times now, trust but verify. So that's definitely a problem, and obviously we've taken the opportunity to address that now. However, I wasn't convinced in my mind that that actually explained the situation in enough detail. It really shouldn't have been enough for that to allow a shim to pop out, given that even when the rocker was contacting the retainer, it was still also in contact with the shim. Let's head back to our data and have another look. All right, if we have a quick look here, lap 15, which was a few laps into Ben's test session. And we look at our engine RPM trace here, and what we're looking for is our maximum point here, which you can see that the engine actually hit 9,198 RPM, which is this point that I've highlighted right here. And this is past the limiter, actually. We've got the limiter set at about 9.1. Interestingly though, if we look at what's happened here, Ben is sitting at full throttle, sitting on that limiter. And if we look at our lower traces here, we've got our ignition cut and our fuel cut count. You can see at this point the green is our fuel cut count, but we can see here that the purple trace, our ignition cut count, actually is incrementing the whole time Ben's sitting on the limiter, which isn't good. So the question of course there is, why was there an ignition cut occurring? And diving back into the M1 tune software, unfortunately, we found that this was a hangover from the ignition cut or the RPM limiter setup that we were using on the 1U ZFE. So it's the same ECU and the same base package modified to suit the SR20. Ironically, this is one of the things that I often point out when we talk about people who want a base file to start running their engine. And my point here is that you're actually always better to start with a blank map and build your base file yourself. The reason for this is, particularly if you're relying on a base map from someone else, there's probably a better than average chance that they've actually made a fundamental mistake somewhere in the system, something isn't quite right. And the reason I say this is that more often than not, unfortunately, this is what we end up faced with because there is such a lack of knowledge out there in the tuning industry. So if you start from a blank map and build it up yourself, concentrate on every single aspect, you're going to get a map that you know is set up right, and you're not going to end up overlooking anything that could cause a problem like this. That's all well and good. Obviously, that's not the situation we're in. There are several reasons for this. One is that with the M1 ECU, this is a really complex ECU. There are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of different parameters that we do need to set up, a lot of which carries across from the 1UZ, particularly running the same gearbox, same wheel speed, etc. So all of that set up, we wouldn't want to necessarily start from scratch there. However, again, in the heat of the moment, given that we are working on a tight time frame here, the rev limiter setup itself, we were using a ignition cut with a fuel cut above that, and that is what's caused this problem. So difficult lesson, particularly when this is something that I am well aware of, but nonetheless, this is something that hopefully you can also learn from. This is a real problem on engines that have fragile valve trains. More of a problem actually on the earlier SR20DE and DET engines, which used a large heavy rocker. Those are really prone for problems even at much lower RPM. There are a couple of other contributing factors around this as well, down to the base spring pressure, which we're going to raise a little bit with the valve springs. But really, this is the root cause of our issue. One takeaway from this situation we've faced though, which is really important to mention, is when you've got an issue like this, or any issue for that matter, it's important to dig down and find out what that root cause of your issue's been. Otherwise, you get into a much worse situation of putting everything back together and just repeating the problem. So no one wants to be doing that. In this case, we got off pretty lightly. There's no real damage to the engine as a result of this. We've ended up pulling the head so that our machinist could fix the retainer issue. Obviously, that one retainer needs to be replaced on the valve where we lost the shim as well. But other than that, there's no actual damage to the engine. So we got off very lightly and things could have been much worse. But again, we need to get to the root cause of the problem. We've found that now, so we can be confident that it's not going to happen again. So where does this leave us? Unfortunately, it leaves us in a pretty tricky situation. We obviously went to our first round at Teretonga, and let's be honest, we all know that didn't go that well. We found this particular issue a day before we were ready to head to Ruapuna. Now, we could have possibly got the engine back together in time, but collectively we decided that it just wasn't worth the risk. We've already had one DNF. We've already had some pretty expensive damage as a result of that DNF. We wanted to quit while we still had an engine that was essentially undamaged, fix the issue and get it back together. with 2 weeks between our second and third round at levels in Timaru, we've also made the difficult decision right now that we're going to pull out of that event as well. At some point, we need to take stock here, and really, we're going to take the same advice that I'd give to one of my own customers. Stop, go back through everything, sort out all of the loose ends that inevitably get left when you're working to a tight time frame and you don't have the time available to finish things to the standard that you want or need to. Test everything, make sure that everything is working properly, and then once you've tested and you know everything's right, then look around and see what race events are available. And that's exactly what we're going to do. Now, no one is more disappointed than ourselves. You've obviously seen through the course of this build series the amount of effort that's been put into this car by everyone, not to mention blood, sweat and tears and a fairly significant injection of cash as well. And the last thing we want to do is pull the pin. Good news here is, of course, we're not stopping. The car will be completed. We are going to continue covering the build of the car. Obviously, at this point, we've still got the aerodynamics to go on the car, but we're going to be covering this in our updated build series as we go. We're going to drop down to doing these build series updates a little less frequently, but don't worry, we are still plowing ahead on the car full speed, and we will keep you up to date with the changes as we go. The idea at the moment is to get the entire systems finished and tested without the aerodynamics, the underbody, the front splitter, the rear diffuser and the rear wing on the car. And once we're confident that everything is working, we're confident that the car is staying cool, at that point we're going to add the rest of our sensor package in terms of laser ride height, brake temperature, shock travel potentiometers, and we're going to add the aero. We're going to test and make sure that that's all dialed in, and then we're going to find an event where we can really do justice to the amount of time that's gone into this build. So stay tuned, we will be back. If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week, and if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.